is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your show host, and very excited to be with you today and do a show that's a little bit different than the standard format. If you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you know that our usual format is to bring on a guest and to conduct an interview format where I interview a guest, an authority in dentistry, and we talk about their area of expertise. However, occasionally I will do a solo show myself that allows us to dive into a particular topic in depth. And today I'm going to do a solo show on the topic of bonus systems in a thriving practice, bonus systems or incentive compensation systems in a thriving practice. The reason why I chose to do this show and do it as a solo format is that I have received many emails from our listeners asking me my advice regarding a bonus system, whether a bonus system is useful, whether I agree or disagree with the idea of a bonus system for team members, and if I do agree with it, what format to follow. And so since I had received so many emails about that, I decided that it was time for us to do a show around the topic of bonus systems and incentive compensation systems. So this one's going to be a little bit different than usual, but I'm sure it's going to be a topic that will be of keen interest to all of our listeners. This is show number 169. I want to provide a little bit of background if you're new to the Thriving Dentist Show, and even if you're a regular listener, I'm going to provide you some new information here that you may not be aware of. This particular show is show number 169. I launched the Thriving Dentist Show in January of 2012 with the goal of sharing useful information with dentists all over the world. Much to my surprise, I expected to have some listeners here in the United States and Canada since I had spoken at most of the major meetings in the U.S. and Canada. I expected that I'd have some listeners in the U.S. and Canada. However, much to my surprise, about 7 or 8 weeks after we launched the show, it literally went viral internationally. So in early March of 2012, the show really started to reach an international listening audience. Today, the Thriving Dentist Show has been listened to by dentists and dental team members in 133 countries. I want to take a minute and say thanks to you. We sure appreciate, we love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but we couldn't do what we do if it wasn't for you. So I want to take a minute and say thanks at the top of the show. Also, at the top of the show, I want to give you some direction. Every one of the shows, all 169 episodes, are available for download. They're all free. You can download those in a number of different places. The most common places that you can download those are from the website, from my website, Takacs, T-A-K-A-C-S, Learning Center, T-A-K-A-C-S, learningcenter.com. Press the tab that says Thriving Dentist Show, it'll take you to the archive of every one of our Thriving Dentist Shows. And every one of those is available going back to the very original show. So every one of them, all 169 episodes are available for download. They're all free. The other place that you can download those is on iTunes. On iTunes, if you're an Apple, if you happen to listen through an Apple device, perhaps an iPhone, an iPod, or an iPad, you can go to the Apple Store. Click on the podcast tab. On the podcast tab, you can then search. And if you'll type in Thriving Dentist Show, you'll see the show come on up. You can subscribe there as well. If you're not already a subscriber, I would invite you and encourage you to subscribe. If you are a subscriber, it's free. If you are a subscriber, that means that every week, every Wednesday, when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded to your listening device. And the next time you plug in your listening device, it'll be ready for you to hear. I'd encourage you to subscribe to those. So that way every Wednesday, you'll never miss a show. But you can also go back and subscribe to any of the past shows. We've really had some fantastic guests on the show. People like Dr. Gordon Christensen. Gordon was on the show and he spoke about the most common questions that he gets at his clinical update courses. He also spoke about his view on the future of private practice dentistry. Also had people like Dr. David Hornbrook. David spoke about how to educate your patients so they're inclined to accept ideal care. Leanne Brady, Dr. Leanne Brady, was another guest on the show, and Leanne spoke about the same topic, how to invite your patients into a conversation about comprehensive care. A couple other listeners that I want to point out, and again, I don't mean to favor any particular listeners. All of the shows have been fantastic. Of course, I'm a little biased there, but all of the shows have been great. In order to be a guest on the show, you have to have two qualifications. Number one, you have to be an authority on your topic. And number two, you have to be absolutely passionate about your topic. I screen all of the guests ahead of time. Most of the guests have been dear friends of mine, some for many, many, many years. In fact, the most recent show, the last show, the 168th episode, was Dr. Bill Williams. And we titled the show, How to Stay in Love with Dentistry After More Than 40 Years. By the way, Bill and I have known each other almost 35 years. So many of the guests have been longtime friends of mine. A couple other shows that I want to kind of highlight because they've received very high download volume and they might be of interest to you is it a show that I did with Dr. Howard Ferran. Dr. Howard Ferran. We playfully titled the show The Best Dental Rant Ever. And if you listen to that show, you can scroll through and find that one. If you listen to that show, you'll understand why we titled it The Best Dental Rant Ever. Howard goes on an amazing ramble through about 40 minutes of amazing information that you just have to listen to. Another one that has been a very popular download is the show I did with Dr. Doug Carlson. Doug spoke about the secrets of dentists who've been able to successfully retire early in their career. So although I don't want you to retire, I'd like you to be able to do that and be able to work because you want to, not because you have to. So anyway, listen to that one from Doug Carlson, because it's titled Secrets of Dentists That Have Been Able to Successfully Retire Early. I've also had my very dear friend Ashley Ladder on the show a number of different times. I consider Ashley to be the finest resource when it comes to patient communication of anybody I know. He does an amazing job of helping you learn how to better communicate with your patients to guide them to accept dentistry. And we did one recently, a show with Ashley that was titled You Are Worth It. And that was a summary of the book that he wrote by the very same title. It's titled You Are Worth It. And it's all about how to communicate financially with your patients so that you can earn the compensation that you deserve as a professional. Another expert that I want to point out that has also been just a great resource and a very high download volume has been also my friend from the UK, Mark O'Born. Mark O'Born. And we recently did a show all about how to have integrity in your marketing and how to use your marketing to educate your audience rather than to sell. And Mark O'Born, O-B-O-R-N, he's another resource that I'd like to make sure that you know about. Of course, we've had many, many, many other guests, but that's a little bit of a highlight reel on some of the most popular ones by download volume. Again, there's 169 episodes, including this one. They're all available and they're free, and I want to invite you and encourage you to download those. And hopefully we'll keep you company as you're driving to work, perhaps when you're at the gym, maybe you're out exercising or involved in some kind of physical activity. That's why I chose the audio format, because it's the most convenient way to digest this information. Also want to extend an invitation to you here at the top of the show. I'd encourage you to visit the website, TACAS, T-A-K-A-C-S, Learning Center, and you'll notice an email opt-in in the upper right-hand corner. If you'll provide your email address, we will immediately provide you with an audio program that's titled Six Proven Strategies to Radically Reduce Hygiene Cancellations and No-Shows. Six Proven Strategies to Radically Reduce Hygiene Cancellations and No-Shows. We actually sell that as a digital product. It has a $97 value. However, if you will leave your email address, you'll receive that program completely free. If you haven't already done that, let me invite you to become a member of our email list. On that email list, I will communicate with you exclusive information that we don't distribute in any other manner, any other format. So if you're not already on the email list, let me invite you and encourage you to do that. Well, let's dive into today's topic. And the topic today is bonus systems or incentive compensation systems for a thriving dental practice. And the first question that I always get is it wise to offer a bonus system or incentive compensation system? And I'm going to tell you the answer to that is it depends. It depends. Now, let me give you a big disclaimer. Number one, I am a huge fan of bonus systems or incentive compensation systems. I've written over 50 articles in the Dental Trade Press, and I have installed bonus systems not only in my own practice, but in practices all over the country, our coaching clients all over the country, and I am a huge fan of incentive systems and bonus systems. Now, with that said, I don't necessarily think that a bonus system is something that every dentist should apply out there. So is it wise to offer an incentive system? It depends. It depends. And how is a good way to answer that? Let me answer it this way. If you have a functional team, then an incentive compensation system can align the doctor's and team members' goals and accelerate practice performance. So if you have a functional team where you guys work well together, we get along well together, and we have a minimal amount of dysfunction. You know, there's dysfunction all the time when we have a team, but if there's a minimal amount of dysfunction, then an incentive compensation can do a great job of aligning the doctors and team members' goals and accelerating practice performance. I really believe that's the role of a bonus system, to accelerate practice performance, so that way the better the practice does, the better everyone does on the team, and everyone is motivated towards that same goal and that same objective. However, let me make this statement in the opening part of this discussion. If your team is dysfunctional, and you know, you're the only one that can really answer that question as to whether it's dysfunctional. But basically, if you think it is, guess what? It probably is. If your current team is dysfunctional, then an incentive system tends to amplify the dysfunction. So it doesn't always make sense to install a bonus or incentive system. However, I am a huge fan of bonus systems and incentive compensation systems when we have a team that is functioning well together. So first of all, if your team is dysfunctional, then rather than just plugging in a bonus system and expecting that to be a band-aid and expecting that to fix the dysfunction, you really need to get at the core dysfunctions and why things are dysfunctional in your practice before you install the bonus system. Otherwise, the bonus system will simply be a pathway to demonstrate more dysfunction among your team. Let's talk about, before I talk about specific recommendations on how to design your own bonus system, I want to talk about the elements of an effective bonus system in your practice. There's a number of elements that, in my opinion, represent kind of the litmus test of whether the bonus system is going to be effective or not in your practice. Let me go through those very quickly. Number one, it must be simple. It must be simple. If your bonus system requires a PhD in math or a PhD in economics to understand, then it is not going to work. I have seen some bonus systems out there. And in fact, most of you know my background, but just a little sidebar for just a minute. As a coach and consultant, I've physically been in over 2,100 practices all over the country and Canada as well. Over 2,100 myself. My life's work has been working with and studying the most successful practices in the country. By the way, that's my day job. On a typical business day, myself and my coaches are in practices just like yours, somewhere around the country to help you develop your ideal practice. I've been in over 2,100, and I have probably seen well over 100 different bonus systems in application. Well over 100. I lost track. I kept track of that for a while, and I got to 100 and stopped counting. But I have seen some wildly complicated bonus systems that the accountant had to explain to the doctor and the team. And let me tell you, if the accountant has to explain whether we made bonus or not at the end of the set period, then it is not going to work because the team members don't know what they did to get it. So number one, when you're designing a bonus system, you want it to pass a certain litmus test of criteria. And one of the criteria I would use is it must be simple. Number two, and this will sound obvious, but it's a very important for this to be in place. Number two, it must be designed in a win-win manner so that it's a win for the doctor and it's also a win for the team members. If either side wins at the expense of the other, then the bonus will fail. So in other words, if it's a win for the team, but then the doctor, has to borrow money to pay the bonus or has to, take it out of his or her pocket to pay the bonus, then it is not going to be something that's sustainable on a long-term basis. So number two, it must be win-win. It must be designed in a manner that's a win for the doctor and a win for the team members. I'm a big fan of the win-win concept. That concept was first introduced to me by the author Stephen Covey. Most of you will be familiar with his epic book that was called The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. He talks about that. One of the 7 habits is that effective people tend to think along the lines of win-win. So rather than win-lose, but win-win. So certainly for your bonus system to be effective over a long period of time and be sustainable, it must be designed in a win-win manner where it's a win for the doctor and a win for the team members as well. Number three, I believe that an effective bonus system must be measurable. It must be based on something we can measure. Now, I have been in many practices that don't have a formalized bonus system, but if the practice has a particularly good month or a good quarter or a good year, then the doctor will provide the team with some sort of a bonus. And while that is great, that's certainly a kind gesture, I don't believe that that really is the best format for designing a bonus system. So again, I if you do that in your practice, I don't want to cast judgment on you or cast judgment on that particular system. But I believe that the better bonus system is one that is based on something that is measurable, something that we can actually measure so the team members can know what they did to get the bonus. If the bonus is something arbitrary, where at the end of a period, it could be a month, it could be a quarter, it could be a year, where we said, hey, we had a good year, here's this, you know, here's a gift certificate to a spa, go have a great time. Here's a gift certificate to a wonderful local restaurant, go have a good time on me. Here's a check. We could all, team members, appreciate having more income. Here's a check for you. While that's appreciated on the part of the team, I would argue that they don't really know what they did to get it. It's a wonderful gift. They appreciate it, but it doesn't represent something that's sustainable and something that can be repeated to produce more results in the future. Number four, and this will come as a little bit of a surprise to you, but have an open mind. Again, these are elements of an effective bonus system. Number four, consider the idea of changing it up periodically, Rather than having a set bonus that goes on for eternity, consider the idea of mixing it up. Now, for many years, I didn't subscribe to this concept. However, a number of years ago, one of my clients, I'll identify him here, Dr. Mark Sweeney, Austin Dental Spa down in Austin, Texas, his wonderful wife, Julie. Julie has an MBA from Vanderbilt University in Nashville, and Julie is the one that inspired me to think differently about a bonus system. She had worked in, coming out of Vanderbilt with her MBA, she had worked in corporate America for many, many years, and she was involved in designing incentive compensations in the different corporate assignments that she had. And she said that she found that when she changed up the bonus periodically, it reduced the likelihood that her team members were going to think of the bonus as an entitlement, and where it's something that's just fixed and something they're entitled to. But by mixing it up periodically, it reduces that entitlement mentality. The other thing that she taught me was that it allows you to change your focus based on the changing shifts of things that are going on in your practice. In other words, there might be a time where a certain emphasis or a certain focus is something that you want to really spend time and attention on. And by changing up your bonus, you can change the way people are compensated based on whatever your goals and directions are. And I have to tell you, when Julie first spoke to me about that, I wasn't convinced that that was a good thing to do. The more I thought about it, the more I experimented with it, the more I came to really embrace the idea of changing up your bonus periodically. And so in today, in my own practice, and I'll share with you in just a minute some of the different systems that I have in place in our client base, as well as in my own practice. But do consider the idea of changing it up periodically. Let me go back over those elements of an effective compensation system. And these are kind of the litmus test. So if you're designing yours or you're considering modifying something you already have or something you've been exposed to, test it against these qualities and make sure that it passes these standards. There's four. Number one, must be simple. Team members must understand what they did to get the bonus. It must be simple. Number two, must be win-win for the doctor and team members. Must be win-win. Number three, must be measurable. Must be measurable. And number four, consider changing it up periodically. Now, I'm going to add a fifth to this. I'm going to add a fifth element that I'd like you to test it against. I believe that the most effective bonus system is one that is most immediate. That's most immediate. If there was any way to stand at the back door at the end of the day and hand out cash to team members at the end of the day, I would encourage that. However, I don't believe that that is the right timeline for distributing a bonus. But I do believe that if you can make it more immediate, the likelihood that your bonus is going to affect the behaviors in your practice goes up dramatically. So for example, I'm not fond of a bonus system that kind of following the corporate model. Most corporate bonus systems, if you look at corporate America, or if you look at, you know, the bonus systems that go on in law firms or accounting firms or investment banking firms, they're annual bonus systems where if the business achieves this goal by the end of the year, then the team members will receive XYZ bonus. I'm not in favor of that in the dental climate. I've tested that. I've tried that. And I have found that it doesn't work simply because the carrot is too far out there in the future to really motivate our team members to stay focused on what they need to do today to achieve that goal. So an annual system, I think, is too far out there. I've used bonus systems that were based on a quarterly payout, you know, the business quarter where it's 3 months. Quarter one is January, February, March, Q2, April, May, and June, Q3, July, August, September, and then Q4, October, November, and December. I have done quarterly bonus systems. However, I'm generally not in favor of a quarterly bonus system for the same reason that I'm not in favor of the annual one. And that is that it still puts the carrot a little bit too far out there in the future. Even a quarter, even 3 months is a little bit too far out there to affect changes in behavior on a day-to-day basis. You probably know where I'm heading with this then. I believe that the proper balance, remember I told you earlier that if the world was perfect and I could figure out a way to design it, I'd design a bonus system where I stood at the back door and handed cash out at the end of the day based on performance, or handed some kind of a incentive out at the end of the day based on the daily performance. I don't believe that's practical. However, I think a good compromise is to have your bonus paid monthly, to have your bonus paid on a monthly basis. I really do believe that a monthly payout is the proper balance between you know, something that is practical and yet something that's as an immediate as possible. Depending on how many days a week you work in your practice, that's typically a 16, 17, 18, could be a 20-day work month. And I think it allows your team members to keep their focus on particular objectives over that time period. So again, let me go over the five elements of an effective bonus system. Must be simple, must be win-win, must be measurable, consider changing it up periodically, and fifth, make it as immediate as possible. And what I'm suggesting in immediate is that you design a bonus system that's paid out on a monthly basis. Now, Let me talk a little bit about some bonus systems I've used in the past, and they could be useful for you, but I also want to explain some of the flaws inherent in those. And as I go through the discussion, I'll conclude the discussion by describing the current bonus systems we use at my own practice, Life Smiles, and I'll explain why we've designed them that way and why I think they are the most effective and why I think you should consider providing a bonus system that's modeled after what we're currently doing at Life Smiles. For many years, I taught a bonus system called an overage system. It's spelled O-V-E-R-A-G-E, overage. It looks like it's overage, but it's actually overage. And let me explain how I designed that system. I've used this in hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of practices. We design a certain threshold, a monthly collection goal, for example, for the practice. And we say that if we collect more than that, we will distribute the bonus to our team members if we collect over that amount. It's an overage system. I won't go into the details about how we design those, but they're basically designed on a number of key KPIs and other key performance indicators. Remember the second goal when you're designing your bonus system, the second quality that I asked you to run your bonus system by a litmus test, and that's that it's a win-win. One of the criteria you can use when you're designing your overage system is to figure out at what dollar amount do you have to collect every month in order for your wages to be at a certain level. The goal for team wages, that includes everyone except the doctor, is 28% or less, 28% or less. That number will vary a little bit depending on whether you're in a an urban location, a rural location, a small town location, a suburban location. That number is 26 to 28%. That's an all-in expense, by the way. That includes all the related expenses associated with that, FICA, FUTA, payroll taxes, all of that. So at the point at which your wages are at 26 to 28% or less, that's the point at which you can then afford to pay a bonus because you've got your wages under control. If your wages are up there at 30% or 32%, you can't afford to pay a bonus. That's where paying a bonus would come at the expense of the dentist, and it wouldn't meet my criteria of being a win-win. So we can do the algebra to figure out at what level your practice would have to collect in order for the team members to receive a bonus. And I'll just use an example in this practice. Let's say that number for you was $80,000 a month. And I'm simply using that number as an example. And that's the number at which your wages would come in at the target percentage. Let's say that number was $80,000. Then we would say for everything we collect above $80,000 a month, we'll go ahead and pay out a bonus to our team members. I usually make the total amount of the payout equal to or less than 20%. So again, we might distribute that to our team members. If everyone was full-time, we might distribute that equally. So if we had five team members, everyone might receive 4% of everything we collect above $80,000. And again, I'm just using an example here for illustration purposes. So let's say that was the case. We had five full-time team members and we decided to make it equal, that every team member would receive an equal bonus. By the way, you don't have to do it that way. You could distribute it in your own formula. But let's say we decide to make it equal. Then we would say that for everything we collect above $80,000, then every team member would receive 4%. So for example, if we happen to collect $85,000, $5,000 above our bonus, then they'd receive 4% of that, 4% of the increase, which was $5,000. They'd receive a bonus check of $200 at the end of the month. By the way, I always put a safety valve in that particular bonus system. For any month we fell below our target, the difference would have to be made up in the next month before the bonus was paid out. So for example, if we had a month where we fell back and we only collected $78,000, then we were $2,000 under the target. And the next month, the base would go to 82. And it would continue to grow that way until we made it, until we made the bonus. By the way, some of you might be sitting here thinking that Gary, does this meet your first criteria of is the bonus simple? And I would tell you right now that we're right on the cusp of it being too complicated. We're right on the cusp. However, I taught that system for many years, and I have clients in around the country today that are still, I'm still encouraging them to use that particular bonus system. We installed that bonus system. Some of you know the story, but if you happen to be new to the Thriving Dentist Show, you know that I'm not a dentist. However, I do own a practice in partnership with Dr. Paul Nielsen. Paul and I own a practice called Life Smiles Dental Care in Phoenix, Arizona. We're in the process of evolving that into our ideal practice. And early on, we introduced that bonus system to our practice. However, after a fairly short period of time, we decided to stop that system. And let me explain. I'll explain in a very candid way why we decided to stop it. And the simple reason was that we chose to distribute the bonus equally, among our team members. And it was equal in regards to whether they were full-time. If everyone was full-time, they received an equal bonus. If someone was part-time, then they received a smaller percentage based on their number of hours in relation to being a full-time employee. However, one of the things we discovered early on was that it wasn't necessarily fair. We had, and this is a flaw, I think, inherent in that overage bonus system. It assumes, if you distribute it equally, it assumes that everyone is contributing at the same level. Well, guess what? That's not true. True confessions here. Not everyone contributes at the same level. We had a couple of team members that were absolutely working their tails off and doing everything they could to make the practice better. We had a couple that were above average in their performance, and we had a couple that were riding on the coattails of the others. And after a short period of using that bonus, we decided to take it away because it was creating more dissension among our team members than it was in terms of unity. So that is a downside to that overage bonus system, is that it could create some dysfunction in your practice. So the overage system is one that I taught for many years, and it's one that I used, and we could change every year. We could change things like the target number. We could change the percentages based on the number of team members that we had. We could adapt that on an ongoing basis, and that could be a useful bonus system for you in your practice. However, let me tell you what we do today at Life Smiles, and this might be illustrate what you might want to do in your own practice today. We have developed individual bonuses for team members that drive particular KPIs, key performance indicators. And these are KPIs that we're interested in, and they're based on tasks that the team members have specific control over. They have specific control over. So in other words, we've designed individual bonuses for team members based on particular KPIs, key performance indicators, that we are interested in driving, but they also have, that particular team member has specific control over. Let me take a minute and kind of explain how that might be, how you might do that. For example, one of our team members is responsible for hygiene recare, I like to call it recare rather than recall. Recall is something that Detroit does for bad cars. However, we have a team member that's responsible for hygiene recare. And one of the things that we measure when it comes to hygiene recare is the percentage of open hygiene appointments we had at the end of the month. Let me share with you a metric or a statistic or a KPI, key performance indicator, that you may not be already aware of, but if not, you'll be aware of it right here. If your open hygiene appointments at the end of the month, count all your available hygiene appointments, and if the percentage of those that went unfilled were at 8% or less, then your hygiene scheduling coordinator gets an A on the report card. I'd love to think that we could fill 100% of the available hygiene appointments, but that really isn't practical given the fact that we will have people that wake up in the morning with the flu, and we will have people that sadly either no-show their appointments or cancel at the last minute. So the A on the report card is achieved when you can keep that open, unfilled hygiene appointment at 8% or less. So one of the ways you might consider this bonus system is to compensate your team member with a very specific KPI. If she keeps at the end of the month, if the open, the percentage of hygiene appointments that went unfilled was less than 8%, she gets X in a bonus. And that number could be $150. It could be $200. That might be the range that I might suggest, $150 to $200. Now, again, $150 to $200 is not life-changing money. However, it is appreciated. It is appreciated. And it is enough to get their attention to focus on certain key performance indicators. And in fact, you could even carry this a little bit further. We have team members in our practice that have a couple of different bonus systems based on KPIs that they are responsible for. You could make it very simple and talk to your hygiene scheduling coordinator and design a dual bonus system. It might go something like this. If the percentage of unfilled hygiene appointments is at 8% or less, she gets $150 at the end of the month. And furthermore, if it was at 4% or less, if she can get it less than 4%, you would double that and give her another $150, which would be a $300 bonus. And again, $300 isn't necessarily life-changing money, but it's certainly appreciated from the team member, and it can provide enough incentive for them to really pay attention to a particular area of your practice. And think about this for just a minute. If you were able to get below 4% and pay $300 in order to do that, that would be a very good return on investment because you've got someone totally devoted to and totally committed to that particular statistic in your practice. Let me give you a couple other variations of that. One of the things I like to track in the practice is the number of outstanding insurance claims that are more than 30 days past due. The number of outstanding insurance claims that are more than 30 days past due. You could tie another incentive to the team member that's responsible for that. It would likely be a front desk team member. And I like to have that number at 20 or less, at 20 or less. So if the person responsible for insurance accounts receivable has the total number of insurance claims at the end of the month, on the last day of the month, if that number is at 20 or less, she would get X in the form of a bonus. And again, I'd recommend that that number be somewhere around $150 to $200. Let's say $200. And say that if the number of claims that was more than 30 days past due was less than 20 or less, she gets a bonus of $200 at the end of the month. So another great way to kind of focus on a particular KPI, a certain performance indicator that you want to be monitored and you want to achieve a certain level of performance, and yet you want to reward a team member who has direct responsibility over that particular area. Since scheduling is so important, scheduling is another area that you could adapt this method of bonus to. For example, let's say our doctor scheduling coordinator, and I'm going to make up some numbers to make this, to be able to explain this example. Let's say that your goal as a dentist is to produce $5,000 a day. And again, I'm just making up an arbitrary number. And again, that would be defined as your goal. And that's not hygiene. That doesn't include hygiene production. That's doctor production alone. And let's say you have one of your team members that's responsible for the doctor production. You could design a bonus system where it says that at the end of the month, if you have achieved the target production goal for the doctor, she gets X in bonus. And you would compute this every month based on the number of work days. So for example, if you had a month where you were working 16 days, and I'm just making up a number, 16 times your $5,000 a day is $80,000. If she, at the end of the month, has you scheduled to $80,000 or above, and again, if that's your actual production, if that's what you actually achieved at the end of the month, then she would get a bonus. And again, I might make that bonus $200. Again, just to use an example, if you're working 18 days during the month, take 18 times 5,000, that'd be $90,000. If you achieved $90,000 or more in production at the end of the month, then she receives XYZ in bonus. She receives this in a bonus system. I just want to go through a couple of other examples. There's many different ways you can design this, and I spend time with our clients customizing this to their practice. Let's say one of the things that you really want to do is you want to embrace whitening in your practice. Those of you that have attended my course, Dentistry Rocks, you know how strongly I feel about embracing whitening. And let's say your practice is hovering and you're not doing as much whitening as you'd like to do. What if we took one of our team members and called her our whitening champion, and we bonused or incentivized her based on a whitening goal? And I like to see us doing one whitening procedure a day, one whitening procedure a day. So if you work 16 days a month, I'd like to see you do 16. If you're working 20 days a month, there's 20. And you simply set it up as a very simple black and white goal. If the practice does more than 16, if it was a 16-day work month, or more than or equal to or more than 20, if it's a 20-day work month, equal to or more than she gets X, Y, Z in bonus. Now, again, she doesn't necessarily have to be the one that does all of the whitening, but she is the champion. She's the cheerleader. She's the orchestrator. She's the quarterback of this. It might be the person that does much of it, but she's the one in charge for kind of keeping this front and center in our practice. We could do the same thing if we wanted to drive a certain number of Invisalign cases or 6-month smile cases if you're doing adult orthodontics. You could tie that to another clinical goal if your goal was to place a certain number of implants. Let's say your goal was to place 10 implants a month. You could decide identify one of your team members as an implant champion. And if you achieve 10 or more during the month, then she would get XYZ in the form of a bonus. I just wanted to give you some other ways and other KPIs that you could use to drive this. It's virtually unlimited depending on what the goals are and what the sub directions are within your practice that we're trying to motivate and we're trying to drive. Now, I do want to speak to one detail related to this type of a bonus system. This is the bonus system that we're using today at Life Smiles, and I love it because it meets all of the criteria. It's simple. You know, think of the one on whitening. If we do 20 or more whitening procedures, our whitening champion gets this. If our doctor scheduling coordinator achieves the scheduling goal for the doctor, she gets this. It meets the criteria of being simple. Secondly, it's win-win. It's win-win. Most of the bonuses are tied to revenue or income that we receive. If you're an office that used to do 5 whitening procedures and now you're doing 20, the increased revenue you receive from whitening is allows you to pay out that bonus. If we're able to fill more hygiene appointments, it allows you to pay out that bonus. If we have fewer outstanding insurance claims, you have the revenue with which to pay the bonus. So it meets the second criteria of being win-win. We do it monthly, so it meets the criteria of paying it out as quickly as possible. Now, what about the criteria of mixing it up periodically? Let me explain how we do this in our practice. We pick a KPI and a bonus for a set period of time. We'll tell our team member that we're going to do this for the next 6 months. We're going to do this for the next 9 months. We're going to do this through calendar year 2015. At the end of the year, we're going to evaluate this, and we might do a number of things at the end of the year. We might continue it exactly as it is because it's working really well. We might adapt it and change some of the numbers based on what we've learned in our experience. And a third option, although we've never done this, but it is an option on the table, we might take it away. We might eliminate it because it's not working. But we set it for a set period of time, generally 6 months, 9 months, or the calendar year, what's left in the calendar year. So it gives us kind of an easy way to have a finish line. There's a fourth option, and that's that we might design an entirely new KPI and tie that person to that one, bonus them based on a new KPI, based on something that's important to us at that particular time. Now, one of the complications of this bonus system is that it does require some administration on your part. Any bonus system requires some administration, and there is some administration involved. However, I will tell you that it's relatively minor. Paul and I do this at the end of the month. It's relatively minor, and it's more than offset by the benefits that we receive, you know, from that bonus system. So, but I don't want to stick my head in the sand and pretend that this is something super easy that doesn't require any work or doesn't require, you know, any effort on our part. It does require some administration, and it does require some effort on our part. However, I will tell you that that effort is more than offset. That's the bonus system that we're using today, where we're picking a certain KPI, a certain key performance indicator, something that's very measurable, and we're assigning a team member to be responsible for that. Then we're bonusing her a certain dollar amount And again, that might be $150. It might be $200. If we had a couple of different bonuses for that particular team member, they might have the opportunity to earn $300 or $400 at the end of the month, which is starting to be something that's very meaningful to them. And we get them focused on a particular area. You know, think about it for just a minute. If we had two bonuses and each was paid out at the $200 level, at the end of the month, the team member, if she hits both of those, will get a $400 addition to her paycheck. If we break that down to it on an hourly basis, that's worth over $3 an hour, over $3 an hour. If you do the math based on the number of full-time hours, and it's over $3 an hour. And that's a nice increase. If you think about, you know, if her wage is already at the top of the scale, we want our team members to be paid very well. And so if her hourly rate is already at the top of the scale, and then she has an ability to make a bonus of something that would be equivalent to about $3 an hour, that can put her absolutely at the top of the scale for her particular position in your area. And that's where we want our team members to be. Which, by the way, brings up another detail, and I'll close on this detail. If you have long-standing team members that have been in your practice for many, many years, and by the way, that is something that I absolutely strive for, and that's one of the characteristics I notice of a very successful practice. Very successful practice typically have long-term team members. That's no coincidence. However, the longer you have a team member, the less viable another year, another raise is. Another year, another raise. Another year, another raise. I know that's the classic system that is in place in many job environments. And however, it doesn't work because at some point they reach the top of their scale. And yet you don't want to say that there's no opportunity for them to improve their income. So what we like to do is to tie it to a bonus. So then the bonus is based on performance. I don't mind raising that person's compensation based on performance that's happening in the practice. So I think that's another reason why this form of bonus system works really well, because it provides an alternative for you to deal with those team members that are already highly compensated. You value them. You don't want them to reach a glass ceiling, but anything they make above and beyond their wage needs to be in the form of a performance-based bonus based on performance of the practice. Well, I hope you found this this Thriving Dentist show useful. I received many, many emails about the request for doing a show around bonus or incentive compensation systems. I hope that you found this useful. By the way, if there's any topic you'd like to see covered in a future show, please send me an email. I'll put my email address in the show notes, but my email address is Gary@Takacs, T-A-K-A-C-S, Gary@TakacsLearningCenter.com. Please send me an email, any topic you'd like to have covered in the future, and I will consider either finding a guest on that topic or doing a solo show on that topic, depending what the nature of that topic is. On that basis, let me simply say thank you. You know, I love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but try never lose track of the fact that we couldn't do what we do if it wasn't for you. Thanks so much. Please tell a colleague about the Thriving Dentist Show. I have a couple requests for you. If you've never done this, you could do me a favor. You know, we have decided not to charge for the Thriving Dentist Show. It's meant to be free. You know, it's something that I simply want to share wisdom with and positive information and motivation with dentists around the world. However, you can help. And one of the ways you can help is you can write a review on iTunes for us. So if you go to iTunes, type in Thriving Dentist Show under the podcast tab and take a minute and write a review. That would be wonderful. That will help more people find us. The other thing that you can do is you can opt into my email address, as I mentioned earlier, if you'll simply enter your email address on my website, Takacs Learning Center, T-A-K-A-C-S, learningcenter.com. Enter your email address. You'll receive an audio program that's titled Six Proven Strategies to Radically Reduce Hygiene Cancellation and No-Shows. That's a $97 value that you'll receive for free. That's another way you can help us out. There's a third option. Follow me on Facebook or follow me on Twitter. If you're on Twitter, follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is Gary_Takacs, T-A-K-A-C-S, Gary_Takacs. or like me on Facebook. I'll put both of those links on your on the show notes that you can find at TacusLearningCenter.com. And if you'll take a minute and like me on Facebook, I'll like you back. Follow me on Twitter. That would be another thing that you could do to support the work of the Thriving Dentist Show. On that basis, let me simply say thank you, and I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.